The next item of business is a debate on motion number 1793 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on devolution of employment services. Can I invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak buttons? And I call on Jamie Hepburn to speak to and move the motion. You have 14 minutes, please, Mr. Hepburn. Can I stop you, please? Seems to be something wrong with your microphone, Minister. You got your card in upside down?
I would never commit such a mistake, Presiding Officer. No, yes, I did. Presiding Officer, let me, at the outset, lest I forget, move the motion in my name. I very much welcome this opportunity today to tell Parliament how I propose to deliver one of the first of the powers devolved under the Scotland Act 2016. That is the power for Scottish ministers to deliver employability support to help disabled people or those at risk of long-term unemployment to seek, obtain and retain employment. Parliament first debated these new powers in April 2015, which marked the start of a process of engagement on the services we want to see in Scotland. We've taken a consultative and collaborative approach to policy and programme development to listen to the views and assess policy options. We've engaged with openness and determination with the UK Department for Work and Pensions and Job Centre Plus, and we've made significant progress as a result. I'm pleased to say we are now coming to the significant point where we move from designing services to delivering them. Importantly, this government intends to deliver new powers for Scotland in the interest of the people of Scotland and with dignity and respect central to our thinking. So, Presiding Officer, I want to set out the way forward for the smooth and seamless delivery of new devolved services and how those services will support people into employment. And today, I will also set out where we will use powers differently in Scotland, including on how our devolved employment programme will interact with the systems of conditionality and sanctions that remain reserved to Westminster. Today is also the opportunity for members to set out their views on these matters. I look forward to the debate. To be clear at the outset, I think it's always useful to have clarity at the outset, Presiding Officer. Today we will not be supporting the Conservative amendment, but will be supporting the Labour amendment. Had it been accepted, we would have also happily supported the Green amendment. We have, Presiding Officer, a significant and unique opportunity to deliver employment support in Scotland. I intend to take that opportunity to deliver employment support service which will reflect fair work and social and economic inclusion, put an emphasis on partnership delivery, building on our strengths in both the public and private sector and a local authority, third sector and specialist delivery, treat service users with respect and have services which will take people with us, encouraging and supporting people into work rather than cajoling them regardless of their individual circumstances. It's fair to say delivering these new powers is not without its challenges. There are limitations in the powers being devolved by the UK government. Devolution is limited to powers to replace the existing contracted services delivered by DWP in the work programme for long-term unemployed people and WorkChoice, a voluntary disability employment service. The devolution committee of the last parliamentary session shared our disappointment that the degree of devolution does not deliver on the Smith Commission's recommendation. Then, only a week after publication of the Smith Commission agreement, the UK government, despite our strong case for swift transfer of powers, announced that rather than devolve services on expiry of their current commercial arrangements in March 2016, as had been agreed, that they would actually extend the contracts to March 2017. Then, in the UK 2015 autumn budget statement, the then UK Chancellor announced replacement of the current programmes with a new work and health programme in England and Wales. That programme is still undefined, meaning disabled people and those who are long-term unemployed in England and Wales still do not know what support services they will have. Members can be assured that we are determined to give people in Scotland certainty about the future support our programme will offer. But by far the biggest impact of the UK spending review has been the massive funding cuts for these services. We estimate expenditure in current DWP programmes in Scotland this year will total around £53 million. In December 2015, the DWP indicated a budget for delivery of new devolved programmes in 2017-18 of just £7 million, a budget cut of almost 90%. As Parliament and the people of Scotland would, I think, expect the Scottish Government to, we have argued that this is unacceptable. It was done with no prior consultation, after we had started consultation on our services, and it significantly undermined our plans. The shifting policy and financial landscape imposed by the UK Government has, therefore, been a challenge for us. We are meeting that challenge head-on, Presiding Officer. We are on track, though, to deliver our programme for government commitment, to deliver devolved employability support services in Scotland from April 2017. We have a clear sense of the services we should aim to deliver, informed by the engagement we have undertaken. Building on that engagement, we will continue to listen to those who rely on these services so we can use their experience in developing our services. Indeed, just this morning, I met with a group of unemployed single parents in Edinburgh this morning with One Parent Family Scotland, and again, I heard how important it is for support to gain employment, to be able to adapt to meet the needs of the individual and flexible enough to recognise childcare needs, working patterns and travel to work issues. We're also responding to the challenge posed by the reduction in funding. Scottish ministers have agreed to provide up to £20 million in additional funding above the reduced settlement from the UK Government to replace the Work Choice and Work Programme schemes. This triples the funding we made available to exercise new devolved powers on employability from the 1st of April 2017. And we have made a further commitment for subsequent years up to 2021 to invest £20 million a year over and above the UK Government settlement to ensure those who most need support can get that support. Our investment means we can create a strong platform for delivering future services from the 1st of April 2017 and in the years beyond. It means we will continue to support the most vulnerable unemployed people in Scotland, including those with a disability. Our aim is employment support in Scotland that meets the needs of people who need support and the needs of employers in Scotland, that reflects the current delivery landscape and helps deliver sustainable employment and economic growth. To start to deliver this, on the 8th of September, I announced a two-part approach to services from April 2017. In Work for Scotland, Scottish ministers will agree a one-year contract with current providers of Work Choice in Scotland. This service will deliver employment support and advice for up to 3,300 people with disabilities with a tailored approach to meet individual needs, including pre-work and in-work support. The procurement process is already underway, and I expect contracts to be signed next month. In Work Able Scotland, Skills Development Scotland will deliver a one-year transitional employability services for clients with a disability or health condition and at risk of long-term unemployment and who want to enter work. This service will provide a combination of advice, support and coaching. This will ensure continuity of effective and accessible support for those who need it most in 2017. This means we're building on existing assets and delivery strengths, both within the Scottish Government and in Skills Development Scotland. Crucially though, the transitional year will also give us the space to define the service we want to put in place from April 2018. That's why engagement with those who are interested in the service we will take forward, such as the meeting I had with One Parent Family Scotland this morning, will continue to be important. Members' views today on these matters will, of course, be useful. Briefly.
Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. Perhaps you're going to cover this, but I just wanted to make sure that you did. So I've been following the exchange between yourself and Minister Angela Constance and the UK Government over your intention to make this voluntary rather than mandatory, which I would wholeheartedly support. I just would just to want to be sure in this debate that we're clear with the Scottish Government and the UK Government have agreed that they will be indeed voluntary.
Jamie Hepburn.
Ms McNeill doesn't need to be disappointed. I will come to that point, but I think our motion certainly clearly indicates the direction of travel in which we want to take things, and I don't think they're too different from where she hopes we will take them, but I'll come to that point later. As part of delivering our employment programme, we are taking forward a wider and longer-term agenda of integration and alignment of services. We are working to align and join up services, working to redefine the current complex delivery landscape and set out where policies could better align with one another, where roles and responsibilities could be clearer across Scottish Government policies and programmes and across local authority and third sector provision. That process, to be clear, Presiding Officer, will not be complete by April 2017, nor indeed by April 2018, but it is one we must begin to ensure maximum benefit for those we need to support. We are also working to align where we can with Job Centre Plus. The Scottish Government has long argued for Scotland to have full powers over employability policy, programmes and delivery, including over the operation of Job Centre Plus. There are still strong and compelling arguments for that, not least the process of better alignment of service I spoke of a moment ago, and with a more coherent set of powers to develop the links between Job Centre Plus and devolved services and the ability to change the culture, focus and approach of Job Centre Plus. But the current political reality is that Job Centre Plus will remain reserved, and it will be a critical conduit for people to pass into devolved employability services. Scottish ministers, indeed this Parliament and much of Scottish civic society, have long been critical of the UK government's approach to mandating, effectively forcing people to take part in work programmes without always considering other issues affecting their lives, leading to too many being sanctioned. Sanctions can often affect the most vulnerable in society, including lone parents, young people and those with a disability. Those who face sanctions are often unable to comply with the conditions they are requested to for a range of complex reasons, including many practical and personal barriers. Even with the devolution of this new area of responsibility that we debate today, the UK government will remain responsible for decisions over claimant conditions in their social security system and any penalties imposed if these conditions are not met. The sanctions regime in operation, it remains the policy and responsibility of the UK government, but it is not the policy of the Scottish government. Existing Scottish programmes to support people in the pathway to employment are voluntary and give people the opportunity to participate in activities to support them into work. Coming to Ms McNeill's point, I believe that we should continue to operate a voluntary approach with our devolved employment programme, where the DWP's conditionality requirement and therefore their sanctions will not apply. In December 2015, the then Secretary of State for Work and Pensions indicated the extent of conditionality in our devolved employment programme was for us to determine. I therefore wrote to the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions, the current Secretary of State for Work and Pensions, seeking confirmation that whilst Job Centre Plus will clearly have a central role in referring their clients into our employability programme, the Department for Work and Pensions should not require that they do so on a mandatory basis, or that Job Centre Plus clients have to take part in our employment programme to continue to receive social security support. The Secretary of State for Work and Pensions has replied to my letter and set out a commitment for us to work together on the approach I want to take forward. He has reiterated too that the conditions in our devolved programmes are for Scottish ministers to determine. But let me be clear, Presiding Officer, I have decided I do not want our enabling person-centred approach to be undermined by participation under threat of DWP sanction. And my expectation, my clear expectation, is that the DWP respect that perspective and our way forward. On that basis, I have written again to the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions today and will continue to pursue this matter with him when we meet next week. Presiding Officer, I believe that these programmes we will take forward will work better if they are voluntary. I believe our programmes will work better if we bring people with us. I believe services will work better if they are designed around people's needs. I believe our programmes will work better if they are seen as an opportunity, not as a threat. I do not believe this will be the case if we enforce mandatory participation to devolved programmes. We will maintain our good progress to deliver services in 2017 with contracts in place before the end of this year. I will announce to Parliament next year further details and progress on our 2018 service. Presiding Officer, the Scottish Government will deliver devolved employment programmes that support people into work and help them tackle the barriers they face into employment. This will be done with fairness, dignity and respect at the forefront of our minds, at the heart of our services. I urge Parliament to endorse that approach this evening.
I now call on Adam Tomkins to speak to and move Amendment 1793.1. Up to 9 minutes, please, Mr. Tomkins.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I welcome the devolution of employment support services. They will add valuably to the Scottish Government's already considerable powers to shape and improve the labour market in Scotland. And there is much in the Government's motion today, indeed much in the Government's approach, that we support and agree with, that employment support should reflect fair work and social and economic inclusion, that employment support services should ensure that people are at the heart of the service provided, and that service provision should treat people with fairness and respect. We agree on all of this. Our amendment to the Government's motion seeks to do three things, Deputy Presiding Officer. First, it recognises that for those who can, work represents the best route out of poverty. And these are not my words, Presiding Officer. They are the words of the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, who've been in the forefront of research into social policy in Britain for decades. Helping people move from welfare into work has been the main driver behind the welfare reform programmes Conservatives have undertaken since we came to office in the United Kingdom in 2010. And it's working. Can I make a little progress and then I'll give away to Mr. McPherson? And it's working, Deputy Presiding Officer. Through the work programme, more than 500,000 job seekers have found work lasting 6 months or longer. Long-term unemployment has fallen to its lowest level since 2009. The number of people claiming unemployment benefits has fallen to its lowest level since 1975. And there are now more than 31.7 million people in work in the United Kingdom, up by more than 2.7 million since 2010. In Scotland, the work programme has helped more than 47,000 Scots back to work. But it's not just about jobs, and the Minister was right to recognise this in his remarks. It's about job security, and it's about the quality of jobs. And here too, there is good news. Not that you'd know it necessarily from what the Minister just said. In the year to August, almost two-thirds of the rise in employment was from full-time work. And since 2010, 95% of growth in employment in the UK has come from permanent employees or people working for themselves. One of the innovative design features of the work programme is the way that it incentivises sustained job outcomes. It's not just getting people into work that matters, it's keeping them in work too. Recognising and welcoming these facts, inexplicably overlooked in the Government's motion, is the second function of our amendment today. I'll give way to Mr. McPherson.
Ben McPherson.
Thank you. I'm grateful for Adam Tomkins for giving way. For clarity and completeness and accuracy, would Mr. Tomkins also acknowledge that the report from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation is also highly critical of zero-hours contracts and insecure work, for example, measures that are controlled at the Westminster level, and is also extremely encouraging about paying the real living wage, the voluntary living wage, which the Scottish Government is promoting at every opportunity?
Adam Tomkins.
Well, on zero-hours contracts, I just said, Mr. McPherson, that 95% of the growth, 95% of the jobs growth in the United Kingdom since 2010 has been in full-time employment or in self-employment. And it was the Conservative Liberal Democrat coalition government in 2013, I think, that legislated to ban the most exploitative zero-hours contracts in the whole of the United Kingdom. In addition, there are also more disabled people in work today. 360,000 people with a disability. 360,000 have found work in the last 2 years who were not previously in employment. In the UK, there are now some 3.5 million people with a disability in work. This is unambiguously good news. But on this front, we recognise that there is still more to do. The disability employment gap has reduced in recent years, and that's to be welcomed, but it remains far too big. And that's why it's Conservative Party policy to halve it. If the SNP would join us in making that happen, they would have our full support in doing so. Perhaps the Minister can say something about that in his winding up. Thirdly, Deputy Presiding Officer, our amendment calls, not at the moment, thirdly, Deputy Presiding Officer, our amendment calls on the Scottish Government to use its powers to address what can only be described as the dismal fact that Scotland has the lowest employment growth rate anywhere in the United Kingdom, lower than the northeast of England, lower than the northwest of England, lower than Wales, lower than Northern Ireland. London has an employment growth rate some five times greater than Scotland's. The East Midlands has an employment growth rate twice that in Scotland. Why? Let me finish the point and then I'll give away to the Minister. Why? Why is job creation so much worse in the SNP's Scotland than anywhere else in the United Kingdom. Does it have anything to do with the chronic skills shortages in the Scottish economy? Skills shortages made so much worse by the 152,000 college places slashed by the SNP. Skills shortages made worse too by the fact that Skills Development Scotland had its budget cut by more than £25 million, that's 13% since 2011. I've already said I'm going to give away to the Minister in a minute. Skills shortages that are hardly helped by the low number of apprenticeships in the Scottish economy. In England, there are nearly twice as many apprenticeships per head of population as there are in the SNP's Scotland. Now, if the Minister would like to respond to any of those points, I'll happily give away to him.
Well, Jamie Hepburn.
I think it's very interesting because what's sauce for the goose is sauce for the gander. Professor Tompkins was suggesting that there was a degree of omission from our motion today. There was a degree of omission from some of the labour market statistics that Professor Tompkins was performing. Perhaps he could reflect on the fact that the unemployment rate in Scotland, according to the last labour market statistics, is somewhat lower than the UK's rate at 4.7%, opposed to the UK's rate of 4.9%, that we outperform the UK on youth employment, unemployment and inactivity, and productivity in Scotland is rising higher than the UK as a whole.
I never heard that.
Adam Tompkins.
Indeed, I'm coming to that, Minister. So what did we hear from the Minister today? What did we hear from the Minister today about the Scottish Government's plans to address any of these problems of skill shortages and apprenticeships? Nothing. Deputy Presiding Officer. What did we hear about why the inactivity rate is higher in Scotland than it is in the rest of the UK? What do we hear about why the employment rate is lower in Scotland than it is in the rest of the UK, or about why the employment rate is lower in Scotland now than it was in 27, while it's higher in the rest of the UK than it was in 27? So it's getting worse in Scotland, but getting better in the rest of the UK. What do we hear about any of that, Deputy Presiding Officer? Nothing. Instead, what we heard was more nationalist moaning about British government policy. We heard not about the success of the work programme, but about its budget. The truth, Deputy Presiding Officer, is that the work programme has worked. Unemployment has fallen by 30%. Long-term unemployment has fallen by 35%. The employment rate in the United Kingdom has gone up. The number of British jobs has gone up. The number of full-time jobs has gone up. The number of women in employment has gone up. The number of disabled people in employment in Britain has gone up. And the work programme has played its role in helping with this. The all-party House of Commons Work and Pensions Committee, chaired by a Labour MP, I note, concluded in a report published at the end of last year that the work programme has streamlined the procurement of welfare to work, has created a stable GB-wide welfare to work infrastructure, and has produced good job outcomes for a greatly reduced cost to the taxpayer. Indeed, for about half the cost of the programmes that it replaced. So instead of bleating, why doesn't the Minister reflect for a moment on whether the programmes the Scottish Government runs deliver for the taxpayer anything like the value for money that the work programme has delivered? Only about 10% of public spend in Scotland on employment support, skills and apprenticeships is spent by the DWP. The vast majority of expenditure is undertaken by bodies that are already devolved, such as Scottish Enterprise or Skills Development Scotland. Do they achieve the results secured by the DWP's work programme? The same job outcomes, the same value for money? This afternoon's debate is an opportunity for this Parliament to discuss all these matters, and it's an opportunity we on this side of the chamber welcome, for there are pressing questions demanding urgent answers from Scottish ministers, and I've raised a number of them in this speech. I said at the beginning of my remarks that I welcome the devolution of employment support services. And I do recognise that the labour market of 2017 and beyond requires different priorities from those we needed in the immediate aftermath of Labour's recession in 2010. But I say this to the Minister. In designing the new devolved programmes, don't throw the baby out with the bathwater. Take what's best about the work programme and work choice and build on them. Don't jettison what's proven to have worked well. So keep the contracted out model. Keep the system free of over-prescriptive interventions from ministers. Let the professionals get on with it. Keep a system of differential payments and avoid the temptation to think that one size fits all. And most important, keep incentivising sustained job outcomes and high-quality job outcomes. I move the amendment in my name.
I now call on Pauline McNeill to speak to and move amendment 1793.3. 7 minutes, please, Ms McNeill.
In moving this amendment in my name, we join with the Scottish Government and all those parties to the Swift Agreement in welcoming the devolution of work support programmes for the long-term unemployed. and other groups who find getting into work difficult. I agree with one aspect of the amendment in the name of Adam Tonkins, and that is that the best route out of poverty is work. But like Ben McPherson, I would also say that it's the type of work that does matter. Programmes for the long-term unemployed should be designed to upskill people and also recognise that the vast majority of people on benefits do not want to rely on them. But one thing is clear to me is that the UK's current work programme is failing too many people who need real and genuine support to find work and attain modern day skills in order to get suitable, well-paid work. In 2014, the DWP statistics showed that work programme contractors had been responsible for twice as many sanctions on the people referred to them as had produced job outcomes. Now, that is just plain ridiculous. A cluttered and inflexible landscape of provision, according to SCVO, inadaptable to the individual needs of people. With ridiculously low figures for those progressing from low skills to high skills, because it isn't just about getting employment, it's about upskilling. I think something is very wrong. But the task is indeed a great one in today's world. The Tinder Foundation said that 90% of all new jobs require digital skills. Two-thirds of employers say that they wouldn't even employ anyone without basic computer skills. But interestingly, a staggering 800,000 people in Scotland still don't have access to the internet, and we must remember that. So the task for any government is a challenging one, but for many, the critique of our service is far worse. Many see the work programme as a damaging and cruel system that forces destitution on those reported for failing to comply with strict and sometimes impossible conditions set. The charity called Mind have called the work programme fundamentally flawed, causing a huge amount of distress without achieving actual results. Their research says the programme is having a negative impact on people with mental health problems, and they report that it's actually making them less able to work. I surely would, yeah.
Adam Tonkins.
If these things are true, I wonder why the member thinks that a Labour-chaired all-party House of Commons committee failed to record any of these criticisms in its report on the work programme last year.
Yes. Pauline McNeill.
So is the minister saying that Mind is making these statistics up? Are you saying that, as I come, when you come on to talk about lone parents, that they're also making these figures up? So I'll let you come back on that when I get to that point. Because it seems to me that the problem is a matter of design. There has been a dramatic increase in appeals with tribunals, with the overwhelming number of those appeals upheld. So what more evidence do you need? There are groups who fear far worse when it comes to sanctions and lack of support. And as I said, one of them is lone parent families. Full conditionality with the most serious sanctions will apply to parents who claim job seekers allowance when their child is 5 years old. And more limited sanctions will be imposed on parents with children as young as 1 year old. So according to One Parent Family Scotland, the regime is also intensifying with the rollout of universal credit. Single parent families with children as young as three will soon be subject to the same conditions. Recent studies on conditionality by a number of UK universities have highlighted that being late or missing your appointment for whatever reason can lead to sanctions and creating desperately poor situations for many people. In one case, they reported a man was sanctioned even although he told the job centre that he had a hospital appointment. Sanctions can be applied for any number of reasons, including that the claimant does not want to apply for a job that the claimant thinks is inappropriate to their skills. And in the case of a friend of mine whose car broke down on the way to an appointment about his self-employed business, he was sanctioned for 6 weeks for failing to turn up to the appointment on time. So I would suggest that there's something far wrong with the system that we have come to know. And of course, as we've talked about in these debates, it can take months to get through an appeal system, and many claimants simply give up because it's actually too difficult for them to navigate. People are often shocked at the reasons that they are sanctioned, And actually, I heard of many stories where people actually are not aware that a sanction is going to be imposed on them. The wide use of the work programme service run by private contractors is sometimes has unachievable job searches with onerous conditions. It really is far from a dignified approach when people are at the lowest point in their lives. So we believe on this side that the cruel and ineffective sanctions regime should not be the basis of the approach in Scotland. Of course, that will largely be a matter for the UK government. But however, as the Minister has said this afternoon, we in Scotland have a chance to create a completely new Scottish service when it comes to the devolved powers we now have. In moving Labour's amendment, I believe, if not all the parties in this chamber, at least agree that we should have a new accord of dignity and respect to all those who need that support in their daily lives. The new Scottish Employability Service could be, as the SEVO has described in its briefing, could adopt a human rights-based approach to helping people into work. So we support the Scottish Government in creating a non-mandatory scheme, provided that it is clearly within our powers. And we believe that it will have better outcomes if people opt in to those schemes. In the exchange I had with the Minister, Presiding Officer, I just want to be clear that although the support, the approach that you're taking, we would not want that to result in an unnecessary fight between the Scottish Government and the UK Government, and I would be asking to be kept appraised of those ongoing discussions, and I give way.
No, you'll have to address it in your closing remarks, Minister. You wind up, please, Ms McNeill.
Yes, I will. From 2018, we'll have full responsibility for employment growth programmes with a transition period that must not result in any detriment to existing users. We must ensure, therefore, that we create a fairer and more dignified Scottish system when we take the powers when they come in 2018. Thank you.
We now move to the open speeches, and can I say we are really pushed for time, so we'll have to be quite strict about 6-minute speeches, no more than. And I call on Sandra White to be followed by Annie Wells.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and can I thank the Minister for his contribution, and in particular the reiteration of people are to be treated with dignity and fairness in delivering employment services, which basically we know are to be devolved, not as much as we'd like, particularly on this side of the chamber, but they are to be devolved and we have to work with what we have. I do welcome the voluntary access to the services supporting people into work. The threat of mandatory participation, the threat of sanctions by the DWP is not only affecting our most vulnerable in society, but in many cases, it is allegedly killing them. And I will come back to this later in my speech. I also want to thank Polly McNeill for her contribution, which does recognise dignity and respect, as is mentioned in the Labour motion also. Presiding Officer, the UK Tory government's decision to cut monies by 87%, as the Minister has already said, for employment support, £53 million down to £7 million. In the words of Martin Syme, Chief Executive of the SCVO, flies in the face of the Smith Agreement and is a clear breach of the no detriment principle. And we have to remember that also. I welcome, obviously, the Scottish Government's additional monies to ensure continuity of employment support. Presiding Officer, as many people are affected by sanctions and by, basically, conditionality also. And I did say earlier on that I did want to return to some of these people who are particularly affected by that. And ones that I would mention, obviously, in the time that I have, are one-parent families, young people, and those with mental health issues also. Now, one-parent families, I think Polly McNeill touched on this in her contribution, do have a very difficult time. They have extra responsibilities that some people don't necessarily have, responsibilities of juggling childcare, and also in many cases, particularly for women, caring for elderly relatives. And it's very important that we look at in a holistic approach, as has been already mentioned by the Minister and the Scottish Government and in the Parliament. We look at these things holistically and not just in various isolated instances. It's very difficult if you're a one-parent family, you have to get your kids up to school, there's perhaps even school holidays, you have childcare responsibilities, and basically you can't always match the hours that you're supposed to work with the responsibilities that you do have. And if you happen to miss an appointment, then you're sanctioned. In one particular case, I know because I'm thankful for one parent families for giving us some contributions towards that, that a lady who tried her very best to be able to get to work with the responsibilities she had, caring and responsibilities for young children, ended up being sanctioned, ended up losing her benefits, and eventually she was nearly losing her home as well because she couldn't afford to pay her rent. And that's what's happening just now. And we take on board what Adam Tomskin says, but this Tory government in Westminster that you are a part of is basically responsible for sanctioning and people putting the most vulnerable people's lives at risk and absolute misery for the way they have to live also. Let's look at young people also. The young people have particular issues too in that respect. Young people sometimes have transient lifestyles. Basically, they come perhaps from broken homes, parents who perhaps don't give them advice also. We have to look at that in particular as well. And we need to make sure that these young kids are treated with dignity also when they're coming either out of care, out of school, and going into the job market. And it's all right for Adam Tompkin to talk about the fact, and I know that Pauline McNeill agreed with that part of the motion. Yes, we do all agree that the best way, and even people with mental health problems, the best way out of anything like that is to get into work, but not at any cost. Not at any cost to push people into work simply because the ideology of the Tory party at Westminster says you must go to work when you may have some serious illness that you can't possibly go to work. It might not be that apparent, and that's when I want to come on to the people with mental health problems. Now, I've visited Sam H, I've visited, I'm sure, other people have also in their constituency, Florence House, particularly Flourish House in my constituency. I've spoken to people, I've heard how difficult it is for them to basically put themselves forward for an assessment and they're sanctioned. They might forget what day it is and they're sanctioned. Just because they happen to have a mental health problem, can't see a bone protruding out, but there is problems there. They may be well taking their medication the day they go forward there to the assessment, but by the time they come out and then they're told they're sanctioned, they're away back down again. And I mentioned the fact about people committing suicide. And I know other, MSPs will have letters. I had a particular case in my constituency where the chap didn't turn up and there was letters through the door. The only reason they found that man and found the letters there was when they broke the door down because basically he hadn't paid his rent and the man was there and he was dead. And he took his own life. And there was a letter there saying he was sanctioned. That's what we're facing. I'm not accusing anyone in particular, but we need to recognise that people have particular problems at times and we should be looking at them with dignity and respect. And I welcome the government's approach to that. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
I have Andy Wells, followed by Alison Johnson.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. In addition to providing financial security for individuals, there are economic, social and moral arguments for that. For those who are able to, work is the most effective way to improve the well-being of individuals, their families and their communities. As of April next year, we know employment services will be devolved to Scotland under the Scotland Act 2016. The Scottish Conservatives have asked that rather than starting from scratch, that we look at what works within the UK system and adapt it to meet Scotland's needs. The Scottish Government is yet to iron... Absolutely.
I mean, surely on that basis...
Minister, if I can just get to my seat.
Well, that's a turn up for the books. That's usually the other way around, Presiding Officer. Ms. Wills will surely welcome the fact then that from the transitional year 2017, we're contracting the exact same providers of the Work Choice Programme to deliver our new service.
Ms. Wills.
I welcome that as well, Minister. And I will come on to that a bit later on in my speech. So, a transitional year from 2017 and then a longer-term employability service from April 2018 onwards. Undoubtedly, accusations today will focus on the employment services of the past and the re-examination of all that is wrong with the system. I acknowledge some of the flaws, the assessment of those with long-term illnesses, for example, and that is why I was pleased to see the new Working Pensions Minister, Damien Green, say only this weekend that those with long-term illness will stop having to have their benefits reassessed, benefiting tens of thousands of claimants. However, repeated criticism moves away from the purpose of the debate today. I want to know from the Scottish Government how its proposed services will give the best support to those who face the greatest barriers to employment, and if there are any elements from the current work programme shown to be working that it looks to carry forward, and we've already said that I understand we are going to be looking at that. Not at the moment, just let me move on at the moment. Let's look at the positives of the UK work programme and work choice, and more generally at the benefits of working with existing local and often voluntary services to create broader systems that meet diverse needs. The work programme between 2011 and 2015 helped nearly 50,000 people in Scotland back into work. And in the wider UK, long-term unemployment has fallen to 480,000, its lowest level since 2009. The elements of support provided very typically involving a regular contact with an advisor, an assessment of the employment needs of the user, IT training and support, and help finding suitable jobs and preparing for interviews. However, I was concerned to read that there are approximately 402,000 young Scots aged between 16 and 24 who are not in education, employment or training, many of whom, as Action for Children Scotland point out, are from disadvantaged backgrounds and require extra support to find and sustain employment. This is certainly something to be gained from working with the voluntary sector. It is great to see examples not only of Action from Children, which runs its own youth build service of companies such as Asda, in collaboration with the Prince's Trust, creating its own Get Into Retail scheme. Stores in Linwood, Govan, Bishop Briggs and Rebroyston offered 17 unemployed young people the chance to gain work experience, accredited skills and training, and a four-week training programme. Crucially, all 17 of the graduates on their most recent programme have been offered permanent contracts. In my own experience working in retail, I was once the champion for Marks & Spencer's Marks & Start scheme, a four-week programme designed to help people with health conditions or disabilities, young people, single parents, and people who are homeless or at risk of becoming homeless. I also want to highlight the success of Work Choice, a programme that provides support to job seekers with a disability through the provision of a wider and more intensive range of support to help them remain economically independent. Since introduced, there have been nearly 12,000 referrals to Work Choice in Scotland, a voluntary scheme, leading to over 9,500 starts and nearly 4,500 job outcomes. Currently run by Shaw Trust and Momentum Scotland, success stories include those such as Her Majesty's Prison Low Moss, whereby the Shaw Trust has delivered a successful pilot project helping prisoners with health problems and disabilities move into work upon release. 100% have moved into employment as a result of this pilot. And I'm pleased to see the Scottish Government has recognised the worth of the programme, setting up its own Work First Scotland and Workable Scotland schemes as part of a one-year contract between Scottish ministers and the current third sector providers of Work Choice in Scotland. Ultimately, as has been mentioned before, I believe that getting people into work is the best way to help them out of poverty. People want to work. We know that. We see it. We've seen the referrals to the Joseph Rowntree Foundation. I want to see the process of creating and administering and employment services in Scotland being done in a way that is positive and can do. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I call Alison Johnson, followed by Christina McKelvey. Ms Johnson, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Whilst some of the parties represented in this chamber, mine included, were disappointed with the overall package of powers that have been or are being devolved by the New Scotland Act, some individual powers can be used in creative and radical ways, perhaps even in ways not anticipated by the UK government when they devolved them. And the devolution of employment services is a very good example of this, and we will have to be creative given the massive cut Westminster has passed on. The current model of employment support used by the Westminster government is a narrow one. Evaluations of the current work programme show that participants are often forced into jobs as soon as possible, regardless of whether it is going to provide them with appropriately paid and sustainable employment that allows them to make progress in the labour market. It risks trapping people in low-wage, low-status employment, as a number of studies have demonstrated. The nature of support offered by the UK programmes is often generic in nature. While help with writing CVs and applying for jobs can be very beneficial for some programme participants, those who have multiple and complex barriers to employment often need individualised packages of support, bringing in physical and mental health services, social services and training. Now, UK governments have tested integrated packages of support like that before, but they weren't included in the work programme. The Condition Management Programme, for example, which helped people manage their health conditions, was lost in the switch over to the work programme in 2011. The assumption was that market competition would drive private sector providers to offer such support, but this hasn't been the case. The DWP's own survey of work programme participants found that over 70% of those on the programme with a health condition weren't offered health-related support to help them find work. So I very much welcome the Work First and WorkAble Scotland programmes, which will assist around 5,000 people with disabilities and health conditions into employment in the interim year between 2017 and 18. And that the government is prioritising those groups left behind by current schemes is certainly encouraging. I also hope that the contracting process for the interim and later programmes recognises the experience and skills of smaller third sector and non-profit providers. They often have the expertise, as Annie Wells was pointing out, to provide the specialist support that is needed to help those furthest from the labour market. And I look forward to them playing a much more central role in Scottish programmes than has been the case with the work programme. And with all relevant services under control of this Parliament, Scotland has an enormously valuable opportunity to provide coordinated, innovative services that support people with multiple barriers into well-paying, long-lasting employment opportunities. As One Parent Family Scotland have argued, employment support for parents can be joined up with the new expansion of early years and childcare. We can tackle the gender gap by not forcing women into highly gender-segregated, low-pay sectors of our economy. As those of us who attended the Equate Scotland reception last week will know, women are desperately needed in STEM subjects. The renewables revolution that we so badly need can be supported by employment schemes that help train people to work in green industries. These are the kinds of opportunities that an imaginative and radical set of employment programmes offers us. And I hope the Scottish Government is willing to invest time, effort and funds in building such a model of employment support. And I'd now like to move to the issue of sanctions. While I accept there are members from right across this chamber who feel very strongly about the negative impact of benefit sanctions, I was proud to stand earlier this year on the only party manifesto that pledged to use the new powers over employment services to significantly reduce the number of benefit sanctions applied in Scotland. In August, the Scottish Greens launched Scotland Against Sanctions, a report which presented original research showing that an average of 13,000 sanctions a year are applied to the benefits of Scottish claimants. It also laid out in detail how sanctions could be stopped should the UK government refuse to refer to Scottish programmes on a voluntary basis. I'm heartened by recent correspondence, and I do hope that the willingness that this should proceed on this basis be continued. But the evidence this report presents is clear. Firstly, sanctions do not achieve their intended purpose. Their positive impact in helping people into employment is marginal and transitory. Secondly, these positive effects are far outweighed by the way they can trap people in low-wage work and their detrimental impact on welfare recipients' health and well-being. And if the purpose of sanctions is to help benefit recipients into work by enforcing participation in employment programmes, they are even more unacceptable when those programmes do not provide a genuine chance for non-employed people to gain work. While it's very welcome that the performance of the work programme has improved year on year, I would suggest to Adam Tompkins that 65% of participants still go through the whole 2 years of the programme without gaining work, and this figure is much higher for people with health conditions and disabilities. The Westminster government is telling people to take part in activity that is more likely than not going to help them, and to do so under threat of having their income taken away from them, and I do not think that is at all acceptable. That is why I very much welcome the motion today pledging that all Scottish employability programmes will be on a voluntary basis. The Scottish Government has said that it wants to build the new employment programmes on the values of dignity, respect and fairness, and making them sanction-free is an important start. Presiding Officer, the devolution of employment programmes is perhaps not the most high-profile power to be devolved by the New Scotland Act, but it is one of the most exciting. I'm pleased that the Scottish Greens have played a part in this process by putting forward the idea of sanction-free programmes, and I look forward to continuing to work with the Government and colleagues from across the Chamber on this issue.
Thank you. I call Christina McKelvey, followed by Mark Griffin. Ms McKelvey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very proud of the Scottish Government in showing real vision, real commitment and a determination to better link up employability and employment. Particular groups face different types of challenges and barriers like disability when seeking employment. But I am concerned about those less obvious groups and individuals who have been left behind by services that don't meet their needs and offer any encouragement to find a suitable job. And we've just heard some of that from Alison Johnson. I believe Scotland can do more. We can do it differently. We can provide effective employment support for physically disabled people, those with special needs or additional support needs, mental health issues, young people leaving care, and people who are falling through the care net, for example. Westminster's current muddled regime, at best chaotic and at worst completely failing, given to two private companies a few years ago and not the third sector where it should have went, will no longer be a break holding back Scotland's productivity. We need to have systems that take a capability approach, which recognises that an individual's wider needs must also be addressed while focusing on their personal employability journey. And we can congratulate ourselves as we talk about the unemployment rate of 5% in Scotland. The problem is that this group is disproportionately made up of those who are furthest from the workplace, those through disability and other barriers who need that additional support. And I do not believe that threats, sanctions, enforced work schemes and the like represent the route towards bringing people into work. These are often people in need of help to build greater self-esteem, to have the confidence and support to learn new skills, and to have skills and training that maximises a person's own potential. There are many reasons, and as many reasons as there are individuals, Presiding Officer, each is unique, but there are things that we as a government can do to improve the life chances. Now is the time for us to make sure that we have the right structures in place and the systems before we embrace these new powers, and that's what we're doing today. These systems need to be person-centred, flexible and properly targeted. Young people leaving care can face challenges like childhood trauma, difficult family relationships, even having nowhere to live. And if you do find somewhere to live in supported accommodation and you then find somewhere to get a part-time job or to go to college or university, you have your housing benefit taken off you, so you lose your support system. That's something we can fix in this Parliament going forward. Young single mothers struggling to manage alone, often feeling isolated and struggling financially. Many will suffer the stress and anxiety, so they feel demoralised and out of control. That in turn leads on to feelings of complete loss of motivation and any real willpower. The conditionality regime hits the most vulnerable with the vicious sanctions. Young single mothers must seek work to claim JSA once their youngest child reaches 5. The whole regime is based on punishment. Turned up 5 minutes late for a job centre interview because your child needed to go to the toilet and you find yourself with no benefits and sanctioned for a fortnight. I have spoken in this chamber on many occasions about the catastrophic effect of sanctioning. Now I want to add those sad observations to the that whether or not a young mum is sanctioned doesn't mean the conditionality regime won't bite. The fear of knowing it might happen is destructive in itself, often leading to depression, stress and anxiety, exasperating existing health conditions, all totally destructive in terms of trying to find a job and getting a better quality of life. On top of that, the conditionality regime forces many single parents into poor quality, low-paid and temporary work. Social security rules actively prevent single parents from improving their job prospects through further education, training or volunteering. Nor, of course, is this getting it right for every child. Conditionality seems to be designed to create fear, anxiety and stigma rather than any positive reinforcement and encouragement. Action for Children tell us the real life story. Alex is a lone parent bringing up 3 children. After a time claiming JSA when she felt constantly in fear of being sanctioned, Alex was transferred to the work programme where the fear continued. Her work programme provider told her she was required to job search for 30 hours per week. Her claimant commitment was 20. That she could be sanctioned if she did not consider work at weekends. That she cannot take her children with her to meetings with her work programme provider, but will get sanctions if she doesn't arrive. That her oldest child can look after the younger siblings. That she could organise childcare at a summer club for her children, even though there was no funds available to pay for this. And that she could speak with the JCP to query her activity requirements over the summer. JCP told her that she could speak with a work programme provider about this. The work programme provider also continuously pressurised her to apply for jobs that did not fit in with the childcare that she could access. Her support worker commented, "Work programme, this is one parent family support worker, work programme demands and activities left her out of pocket, affecting her confidence, sense of self-worth, and in turn a negative impact on her children during their school holidays. When she, as the sole carer, was not in a position to hide as much as she could and to give them what she can." Now, I'm sorry, but that is not getting it right for every child. I am sorry, that is not supporting people into work. That is punishment, absolute and utter punishment. And if we want families and continues to be productive, to be involved in their communities and to get into the work that's sustainable, then we need to change how we do things and create a system in Scotland that's fairer and that puts dignity and respect at its heart. And for every minute of my breath the next 5 years in here, that's what I'll fight for.
Thank you, Ms. McKelvey. Mark Griffin, to be followed by John Mason. Mr. Griffin, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This Parliament will break new ground simply by taking over control of employment support services. It'll be unprecedented when we begin to take charge of the help to provide, of the help provided to disabled people. And it'll be historic when a social security bill is debated and passed by members present here today. A groundbreaking, unprecedented and historic. Those will be at the forefront of the message to the public for the changes in the coming months and years. But this must be a time when we, as politicians, must tread carefully with our language. This is a time when we should and must be humbled by the challenge ahead of us, because it will be outcomes that matter. And we should start this debate by asking ourselves what kind of society we wish to see for our children and grandchildren. What support is required to help create it? And in this place, we have a majority that have campaigned and worked against cuts in mobility support. We have politicians of all stripes who have fought to build the chances, the work chances of our disabled. And we have that drive that keeps us awake at night, wondering how we can better help those who devote their lives to caring for our loved ones. And I'm grateful to those who have got us to where we are today, the battles for recognition waged and won, prejudices challenged and beaten back, perceptions changed in our communities and workplaces, expectations raised, met and exceeded. And rightly that expectation is building once again, building in light of the challenges still faced by disabled people today, challenges which campaigners are fighting against every day. Campaigners who will be watching closely how we approach these new powers. It's an expectation not just for those directly affected by the powers will hold, but for the country as a whole. An expectation of a system that doesn't tie up disabled people in red tape and punitive sanctions. An expectation of a system that preserves people's independence and provides not just a safety net to allow them to survive, but a springboard to playing a full part in society. An expectation of a system which moves us beyond the idea of social protection into a new dawn of social enhancement. An expectation of full social engagement, participating in education, employment, being able to volunteer, to care for your kids, and simply enjoy and live your own life. I think the sentiment of the government motion suggests there is a consensus to be found with those of us in the Labour movement. That leaves options for the minister. He can look to those who have overseen the precipitous decline of government help are those who seek to raise the bar still further. It can look to those who have marginalised our most vulnerable in our society or those who seek to uplift them. It can look to those who restrict the support for those facing challenges or those who seek to enhance it, and I appreciate the government support for our amendment today and showing which side he's going to look for support and collaboration. Because we in the Labour movement have a long-standing belief that when barriers block the path of the one, that path is blocked for all of us. That when one person is left behind, we cannot advance together. That if this government decides to bring about meaningful change, to build a system that will enhance the lives of our disabled citizens, that ensures those who find themselves out of work are treated with compassion, that reflects the language in the motion today of fairness and respect, he will have our support and that of the Labour movement. The future of employment support in this country requires us to work together, and not with our eyes clouded with political grievance, but with our focus firmly fixed on the expectation of a nation, and that point that Pauline McNeill raised, on not seeking to cause artificial fights between governments, but seeking meaningful solutions to the problem. And I'm happy to take intervention from the Minister that he may have been seeking to make on Pauline McNeill on that issue of discussion.
You're actually in your last minute, sorry.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Presiding Officer. I'll conclude, and perhaps the Minister will be able to sum up on the progress that has been made between governments on discussions around sanctions. I think there are times in this country when we do go about our own business, enjoying opportunities that we've been blessed with. Sometimes we campaign on political base, sometimes we campaign together on particular issues that we hold close to our hearts. But then there are times that we do need to come together, inspired, I think, by the dignity of the individual, those people who many members in the chamber today have identified their individual circumstances that they face. I think we have to unite and help build and shape a shared future that will improve the lives of the many people that members have spoken about. I think today is one of those days. And thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. My hand signals eventually had some effect. John Mason, followed by Maurice Golden, please.
Thank you, Mr. Mason. Presiding Officer. I very much welcome the opportunity to speak today. And it's great to see that some level of the benefit system is being devolved, even though many of us would like to have seen more. Now, I would like to focus my comments today on three main topics, and the first one is attitude. I would first like to make a few comments on attitude, and that is what I mean, the whole attitude of any employment service that we have. And following on from that, how applicants are treated. Mark Griffin mentioned the word compassion, and there's many other words we could use. Now, of course, any system has to have rules and regulations that have to be adhered to, and someone has to pass on unpopular decisions. I accept that. And first of all, I think I want to stress that there are many individuals who are working really hard and really well within the DWP and doing a great job. However, it is not acceptable that people applying for a benefit should be treated like they are a piece of dirt. And yet, too often, that is how many decent people feel that they have been treated. Any of us can fall on hard times, ill health, or losing a job, just as any of us might need a passport, dental treatment, or some other public service. So in all of these cases, we should be remembering that we are talking about a public service. Now, of course, all public services can be abused. Some library users might be there to vandalise the books, but we assume that the vast majority are there for good reasons. Some patients might be deliberately wasting the doctor's time, but again, we assume that the majority are there because they really need medical help. And in the same way, we can and we should assume that the majority of those looking to claim benefits are doing so for genuine reasons. This is a public service, and it is there to serve the public. I should expect the same level of service and respect and helpfulness when I use employment services as when I go into, say, Slater's to buy a suit. I think this point ties in with the briefings from Bernardo's, which talks about, quote, a more individualised programme, unquote, and also from Action for Children, which emphasise the need of disadvantaged young people. They say in their briefing they want to see employability support services, quote, which are young person focused, flexible, and inclusive of different approaches, unquote. That is the point. It cannot be one size fits all, any more than it is one book that fits all in our library service. And finally, on this point of attitude, I would say that this does not need to cost any money. We should be able to provide the same services for the same cost, but in a better way than we have been doing. Secondly, conditionality. Now, I accept that some benefits may be subject to conditions, but I also would argue that every person in this land has a right to a certain basic income. Now, further down the line, I would like to see us looking at a citizen's income or universal basic income, which would be guaranteed to every citizen and would have no conditionality at all. However, I accept that that is more of a medium-term objective. But here in the short term, we can still look at this question of conditionality. And I believe there is a moral side to this argument. If the worst people in our society are in prison, yet they are guaranteed food and shelter and warmth, how come decent people who are disabled, who have lost their job, are not also guaranteed that minimum? We are treating disabled and unemployed people worse than prisoners when sanctions are imposed. If someone is to be fined in court, they have many safeguards before that actually happens. Yet sanctions can be imposed on vulnerable people with very few safeguards in place. Now, I do accept that benefits above the minimum could be made conditional, can be made conditional. But I do not accept that benefits at the minimum level, the level where they're meant to be keeping people alive, should be conditional. Finally, on disability. Now, I accept that there are particular challenges helping some disabled people into work. Employers may be unwilling to adapt a workplace or workplace practices, or they may not be aware of the help that they can actually receive to do this. I found it fascinating yesterday at the Economy Committee to hear that disabled people in the southeast of England have been much more successful at finding employment than in other parts of the UK. That seems to be because there are skill shortages in that area, and employers have discovered it is very worth their while to make adaptations and so employ disabled people who have the skills that they need. That proves that if employers have the incentive and support, they will take on disabled people. But also, it can be very hard for disabled people to compete in the marketplace when there is no shortage of labour, as perhaps is the case in other parts of the UK outside the southeast. I still think there is a place for supported employment in some cases, even though I do accept that the main aim of our policies should be to integrate disabled people into mainstream workplaces. It was disappointing to lose many REMPLOY jobs, and I do welcome other provision in the likes of Glasgow and Falkirk along these lines. Presiding Officer, I'm very grateful for the opportunity to speak today. Employability services has much to do with finance and the economy, but please let us not forget that it also has a lot to do with individual people and with our moral responsibility as a society. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Maurice Golden, followed by Ben McPherson. Mr. Golden, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Today I would like to focus on employment support for individuals with disabilities and the role public procurement can play in securing employment for those who are disabled or disadvantaged. Before that, I want to make clear that work must always pay. It must always be more rewarding to be in work than to be on benefits. Employability programmes are important, but just as important is that Scotland is creating jobs, the economy is expanding, and that Scotland is open for business. Sadly, the SNP government have let down Scotland on this front, with the economy stalling and output flatlining. In terms of employment support, the Scottish government should be doing everything it can to ensure that people are supported to prepare for, find, secure, and retain employment. I would like to commend Scotland's range of supported businesses in providing employment to individuals with disabilities, and I recognise that this is right to provide transitional funding over the next year to organisations through the proposed Work First Scotland programme. However, ageing workforces, low numbers of younger employees, and a lack of onward progression to the open job market are key challenges within supported businesses. The Scottish Government should explore what it can do to aid supported businesses to reshape their businesses to give disabled workers every opportunity to move into open employment. Those supported businesses who provide onward employment outcomes should be incentivised for doing so under Scotland's specialist employability programmes post-March 2018. Disabled individuals employed by a supported business should be given the training, support and encouragement to move on into the wider job market. Supported businesses should, in the first instance, be seen as providing a route to conventional work and not a long-term destination in their own right. Of course, I recognise that, for some, prolonged employment within a supported business may be the best long-term solution. Successfully balancing the commercial and social aims of supported businesses is undoubtedly a significant challenge, and the Scottish supported businesses sector is under considerable strain. It is worrying the rate in which supported businesses are disappearing across Scotland as we risk losing these valuable assets going forward. The Scottish Government and the wider public sector must do all that it can to lessen the financial pressures being placed upon supported businesses to ensure their long-term viability. One of the most effective ways to do this is to increase the opportunities for them to succeed in public sector procurement. I commend the Scottish Government on the National Collaborative Framework Agreement for Supported Factories and Businesses. Nevertheless, the scope of this framework is too narrow and does not cover the range of goods and services that can be delivered by Scotland's supported businesses. Furthermore, public bodies are falling short of their commitments to use reserved contracts for supported businesses as outlined in their sustainable procurement action plans. New opportunities exist for the public sector to do more, as recent amendments to EU procurement legislation have significantly broadened the scope on the use of reserved contracts for supported businesses. Critically, the profile of an organisation that a public body can award a reserved contract to has been lowered from 50% of the workforce who must be disabled to 30% of the workforce, as well as broadening the scope to include economic operators whose main aim is the social and professional integration of disabled or disadvantaged persons. The inclusion of the terms economic operators and disadvantaged are crucial in this because, in comparison to a handful of organisations that fulfilled the old criteria, suddenly hundreds of social enterprises and third sector organisations who provide employment support to those with disabilities and or who are disadvantaged in the employment market can now be brought into the fold. The Scottish public sector now has the legal framework that, if it chooses, can revolutionise the way in which contracts for goods and services from supported businesses, social enterprises and the wider third sector. Ultimately, this spend can drive wider positive social impacts through procurement and support the employment of those who are most disadvantaged in the job market. In conclusion, supported businesses must increasingly act as a transition mechanism for disabled employees to the open job market, and public procurement must drive the support for the benefit of those disabled and disadvantaged. 3 seconds to spare.
Thank you, Mr. Gould. Yes, I can see the clock as well. Ben McPherson, followed by Alec Rowley. Mr. McPherson, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's great to speak in this extremely important debate about how we assist the most vulnerable in our society and how we help get people into work and keep them there. My speech today, I just want to cover four main areas. The ethos in which we approach using these new employability powers, the context in which we are in, some comment on the proposals from the Scottish Government and how we deliver them. And firstly, ethos relates to what John Mason said about attitude. Today we are debating employability services, but it is also, we are considering how we motivate people into work. Do we use the carrot or the stick? Which is more meaningful and effective? Encouragement or threats? A lift up or the fear of a put down through sanctions and conditionality? And as has been said by many other speakers, but is also my own personal experience in different sectors, from hospitality to engineering, from the commercial world to working briefly in the public sector, is that in all these roles and in wider society as a whole, a person who is appreciated and respected and invested in will always do more than what is expected, and that encouragement and empathy and belief and generosity are always going to help those in need in a more meaningful and effective way. In essence, it's better to provide support than get to the position where we need to pick other people off the floor. And that's the context in which we should approach using these new powers and the social security powers coming to this Parliament, to design governmental systems, to implement governmental systems where we support other people with encouragement and respect and dignity. And with that ethos and attitude, we also need to approach these new powers with a sense of context, a context around where have we been, where are we today, and where do we want to go. In terms of where have we been, the past is a process of deindustrialization, and the financial crisis, austerity, many aspects of intergenerational poverty, low morale and low self-belief in many of our communities. And everything that we do in this Parliament with these new powers should be about getting past that and doing what we can with the limited powers at our disposal to tackle these hugely difficult and challenging issues. In terms of the present and the context, these issues are particularly raised by my constituents, but they matter to the whole of Scotland. The issue of low pay, which has been endemic in far too many parts of our country and in our communities. The problem of 0 hours contracts, which I raised earlier, which are creating really difficult circumstances for many people who are trying to get into meaningful work and get beyond the challenging circumstances that they're in. And also the problems around the current approach of the UK government around sanctions, which was spoken about most powerfully by Sandra White earlier. Not only is this punitive and wrong-headed in my view and in the views of many, but it also doesn't work. You know, for example, Citizens Advice Scotland have said that 90% of their frontline staff do not feel that the use of sanctions and conditionality works in any meaningful way. And also in terms of context, I think it's really important to consider the fact that there's been an 87% cut to the budget in terms of delivering these programmes, and that is the situation that the Scottish Government is in. In terms of the future and where we want to go, we want to create a system around employability where we support and realise the potential of more of our people for the benefit of us all. And that is why I warmly welcome the Scottish Government's approach to use the powers coming to this Parliament to focus on disabled people and people at risk of long-term unemployment in a way that is designed to help people get into long-term stable jobs. And I particularly welcome the point that the Minister made that these will be voluntary schemes that bring people together within the system, within the devolved areas, aligning them with other aspects of the public sector and ensuring that these programmes are seen as an opportunity for people and not as a threat. And I also welcome the £20 million of Scottish Government support, particularly in light of the cut that I mentioned earlier. So in that context of the proposals that the Scottish Government are putting forward and the cuts and conditionality that are being implemented by Westminster in terms of the cuts and the conditionality that will and the sanctions that will remain under Westminster control, I warmly welcome the fact that these the Minister has corresponded with the Secretary of State for Work and Pensions and confirmation that the DWP will not require on a mandatory basis that Job Centre Plus clients have to take part on any Scottish Government programme to continue to receive their support. And just briefly, because I know I'm in my last minute,
In your last 30 seconds.
I'd just like to emphasise the point that Alison Johnson made about how we could use the third sector to help deliver some of these programmes going forward and get away from everything coming through Job Centre Plus. There are many organisations in my constituency, like the Cyrenians, Fresh Start, North Edinburgh Childcare, Citadel Youth Centre, Granton Youth Centre, who all have some expertise in this area. And anything that we can do to help in the delivery mechanism will make a meaningful difference. So I look forward to the positive change ahead in this area, despite the challenges of an 87% cut by Westminster. And I look forward to playing a part in the implementation and delivery.
Thank you. I call Alec Rowley, please, be followed by Ruth Maguire. Mr. Rowley.
Presiding Officer, I welcome this debate today. And it is clear from the discussion so far and from the level of interest generated in this subject that in Scotland, we have the opportunity to get this right for every person who needs to access these services. I want first to look at the importance of skills. In a brief from SCVO, they highlight the number of interesting statistics, one of which is that despite the high levels of investment, there remains a skills mismatch in Scotland, and 69% of businesses in Scotland are not confident about filling high-skilled jobs of the future. Indeed, if you look at most areas in Scotland, in the building trade, in the care sector, in manufacturing, in so many sectors across Scotland, there are major skills shortages. So we should be clear from the outset and make sure that the employment support programmes that we develop here in Scotland are meaningful in that they will equip people for the world of work. I speak as someone who started off their working life on a YTS programme. And I say employment programmes must be about more than meeting targets to get people off benefits. Their main objective must be to provide the support, the guidance, the signposting, the direction, and the training opportunities that will result in good paid, sustainable employment. And if we're to achieve this, then I would suggest we need joined up strategies based on local intelligence in terms of the support and skills needs locally and the availability of employment in the local area and region. And services must be designed to meet people's needs rather than people being expected to fit into some kind of government programme. The example from the SCVO of their work in Glasgow, where there was a requirement and a demand for support with numeracy and literacy, is a good one. One I suspect that we would find in all parts of Scotland. As they put it, without basic education, young people are unable to participate in further education, training, or employment. That is, of course, also the case with adults. And to simply put people onto employment programmes without addressing their basic support needs is simply to tick a box, get people off benefits for a short period of time and do very little to help them improve their prospects for the longer term. So any system, any programme that is to work for the individual, for that person, must have a comprehensive and personalised initial assessment. A kind of individual work plan that sets out how that person or what that person's support needs are and the progress being made to meet those individual needs. A person-centred work programme is what we need to strive for as we develop these new programmes in Scotland. I would also suggest that we must devolve much of the responsibility for the development and management of employment programmes to a regional level across Scotland. The report from the Joseph Rowntree Foundation, We Can Solve Poverty, published just a few weeks ago, makes the point that devolution is one of the defining political agendas of our time. They say, and I quote, "Poverty will not be solved from Whitehall or by central government alone, but by policymakers closer to those people experiencing it." I say today that we must move beyond Holyrood and take the new powers and budgets much further down to achieve the best results for the people of Scotland. The Roundtree report also states local authorities can play a leadership role, developing an economic vision tailored for their area, bringing together local partners to deliver it. So for me, we must build a partnership at a more local level. Such partnerships must bring together businesses, employers, trade unions, setting regional skills and job strategies and putting in place whatever provision is required to deliver a person-centred approach to getting unemployed people into good, sustainable employment. I have to say that whilst I have been a vocal supporter of community planning, I do not think the objectives have been achieved in most areas, and it has become a bit of a tick-box exercise for professionals in public sector organisations and has failed to properly engage with key stakeholders from the third sector, from employers and from trade unions. So a rethink on community planning, but the principle of planning and delivering skills, training and jobs at a regional and local level is, in my view, a must, and we should be willing to start looking and use these new powers and services and talk with partners right across the third sector, right across local government, taking a local approach, a regional approach, and most importantly of all, a personal approach to the individuals concerned.
Thank you, Mr. Rowley. Ruth Maguire to be followed by Willie Rennie. Ms. Maguire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak in this important debate on the devolution of employment services. It's deeply regrettable that funding reductions from the UK Government for these important services are almost 90%. However, I welcome the commitment from the Minister to provide additional resources to ensure that services to the most vulnerable in Scottish society, including people furthest away from the job market and disabled people, continues. Today, Presiding Officer, I would like to focus on the Scottish Government's commitment for these employment services to be voluntary services and why that's so important. We need services that support people into work rather than the mandatory participation and the threat of benefit sanctions that are currently used by the UK Government, which frankly do nothing to increase someone's chances of accessing good quality, well-paid employment and simply pour human misery on human misery. Most members in this chamber will have experience of hearing firsthand how conditionality and sanctions impact the lives of their constituents. And only this week I heard from Jonathan, a young man who lives in my constituency. He told me he feels let down by the way he's being treated and gave me permission to mention him in this debate. Jonathan told me that the latest sanction imposed on him 2 months after an alleged infraction resulted in him having £74 taken off his universal credit. £74 when he's already struggling. He told me it made him feel worthless. Presiding Officer, this young man suffers from depression and anxiety, and you don't have to be a mental health professional to understand that taking an aggressive and punishing approach will worsen mental health conditions and make it harder, not easier, for people to return to work. Presiding Officer, we've heard many times sanctions often affect the most vulnerable in our society, lone parents, disabled people and the young. Sanctions leave people unable to pay their bills, rent or debt repayments and put tenancies at risk, resulting in a threat of homelessness. Christina McKelvey made the important point in her speech that it's not just the actual sanction and loss of income that itself causes harm, but the fear of sanctions causing stress, anxiety and depression. One Parent Family Scotland agree, and they also point out the real danger that conditionality regime and fear of sanction forces parents into low-paid and temporary work that's not in the best interest of them or their children. Our goal must be to support people into decently paid, quality work and not frighten them into unsuitable employment. And Presiding Officer, as both Pauline McNeill and Ben McPherson said, the worst of it is that all this harm, hurt and stress doesn't help at all. More people are sanctioned because of the work programme than obtain jobs from the work programme. In Scotland, 46,265 sanctions were applied between June 2011 and March 2014. During the same period, 26,740 job outcomes resulted from the work programme. Presiding Officer, I'm a member of the Social Security Committee, and in evidence sessions with key stakeholders, the negative impact of sanctions have featured highly in discussions about what priorities should inform our work programme and our consideration of how the Scottish Parliament approaches the new welfare powers that are being devolved here. At our 8th of September meeting, all of the following respected witnesses highlighted sanctions as having a particular detriment on the groups of people they work with. John Dickey from the Child Poverty Action Group, Rob Gowans from Citizens Advice Scotland, Alice Mumford from Engender, Kayleigh Thorpe from Enable Scotland. All trusted, respected organisations, clear about what helps and what harms the people they work with. A number of bodies and studies have also drawn attention to the fact that sanctions and benefit delays are the most common cause of some needing to access emergency food aid. For example, emergency use only, a report published jointly by the Child Poverty Action Group, the Church of England, Oxfam GB and the Trussell Trust in November 2014, say that sanctions featured as one of the main reasons that people use the food bank, and it was around 20 to 30% of food bank users had had their benefits reduced due to a sanction. It's frankly astounding that the UK government has continually failed to recognise the damage that conditionality and sanctions have on people and their dependents, and the harm it inflicts on their ability to participate in society. In closing, Presiding Officer, despite the drastic scale of funding reductions being imposed by the UK government, I'm reassured by the Minister's statement that our Scottish Government employment services will treat people with dignity and respect, putting the needs of individuals at the centre of services and never, ever forgetting their purpose, which is to help people reach their full potential and secure good quality, well-paid employment.
Thank you very much. Call Willie Rennie to be followed by Alison Harris. Mr Rennie, please.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, for finding the time this afternoon to allow me to make a contribution to this important debate. I don't know if William Beveridge had as many people in the room watching the architect of the welfare state creating that welfare state, but I counted a couple of dozen people in the gallery this afternoon, and I don't think that really reflects the significance of this day. We should actually have the gallery packed, because actually what we're doing today is creating a new Scottish welfare state, and I think the debate deserves that kind of attention. Now, I'm grateful for the Minister's contributions this afternoon, but we should be thinking very big about what the opportunities and potential is for this new welfare state. And the foundations that we're setting today, I think, are probably broadly the right ones. I think being able to establish it on the base of respect, dignity, and fairness is something that we would support. We will support the SNP motion this afternoon and the Labour amendment. And unfortunately, we will not be able to support the Conservative amendment this afternoon. But however, I think the spirit of the debate this afternoon shows the seriousness upon which we all address this matter. And we are here this afternoon because the Smith Commission did go further than was originally intended. We did not intend to devolve as much of the welfare state as we eventually did. Now, there may be some quibbles about eventually what came, but the Smith Commission, as the Conservative members will know, and others, that went much further than was originally intended, including the employability schemes. Yes, certainly.
Minister?
Of course, that may be the case, but Mr Rennie, I'm sure, would agree with me that it is the case that the Devolution Committee of the last parliamentary session said that the legislation that came forward through the UK Parliament did not go as far as Smith had recommended.
The S&P dominated committee would say that. But what the reality was is we've got something here, and we shouldn't quibble about this. What we should be doing is seeking the opportunity to work in a partnership. And I know the Minister bemoans the fact that Job Centre Plus hasn't been devolved. But as Mr Swinney and Michael Moore, my former colleague at Westminster, were very good at, was working in partnership together to bring the two governments to work together to make a better whole. And I think that should not be precluded in this arrangement too. So we have developed, I think, today the start of a cross-party effort, as William Beveridge achieved all those years ago to create this new Scottish welfare system. I think that is incredibly important that we do that and we do that together. But work, as has been said, is the best route out of poverty, and we need to make sure that everybody understands, although we have views about sanctions and the voluntary nature of this scheme, that everybody understands they have a responsibility to work and to contribute towards the well-being of society. We do have an ageing population, and there are still large numbers of people in Scotland, however, who are not contributing to the economic well-being of the country. And we should be encouraging and incentivising them to work as if they possibly can do. And that's what the system should be devised to do in order for us to create that sustainable economy for the future. And actually, all of this is not just should be founded upon the employability schemes. Our education system is failing just now. We do not have an education system that is training people for the world of work. We need to be investing more, in my view, all the way back to nursery education to give young children the opportunities then throughout their school life and through to college and university to contribute towards the world of work, because that should be the incentive. So we shouldn't just be looking narrowly at the employability schemes, but throughout the whole education system as well. And I did hear a contribution from an SNP member earlier on parading his views about the proper living wage. But just yesterday, we heard about Amazon in Dunfermline that's recruiting quite a lot of new people, but all of them below the proper living wage. And that company received thousands of pounds, millions of pounds of grants from the Scottish Government. I think there should have been a compulsion on Amazon to pay the proper living wage if they were going to receive government grants. So let's practice what we preach. I think that is important in this context. Now, the devolution of the employability schemes does give us the opportunity to bring together the different stakeholders to work together. Skills Development Scotland playing an important role. That will give us the opportunity to drive efficiencies through the system and learn from best practice here in Scotland. But I would agree with Alison Johnson, who's not here just now. Alison Johnson, when she referred to the third sector contribution, I've met many charities and third sector organisations that could make a big contribution because they understand their clients and the people who seek their support exceptionally well. So I hope they are brought into the system to make full use of that knowledge. Now, turning to the issue of sanctions in the last 30 seconds. I agree the system should be voluntary. I agree that we should be incentivising and encouraging people to take up the opportunity of the employability schemes. I agree that the overbearing, overused and counterproductive sanction regime is not appropriate for the employability schemes. That, I think, should be at the centre of the approach going forward. And that's why I'm happy to support the motion today.
Thank you very much. Alison Harris, followed by Ive McKee, with the last speaker in the open debate. Ms Harris, please.
Deputy Presiding Officer, I am pleased to contribute to this debate today, especially as it is on an area in which the UK Government has yet again honoured the promises that it made. The agreement to devolve powers over employment services means that this chamber will become responsible over key areas such as the existing work programme and work choice. Soon the Scottish Government will have the power, and with that power, the responsibility. Time for always blaming someone else to stop. Scotland needs a can-do and not a can't-do government. Now the Scottish Government needs to tell us how it will incentivise work, how, without sanctions, it will limit abuses to the system, how will any additional costs be met, and how, for all those seeking a route to employment, will any new system better exist? I'm sorry, I've got too much to do. I do hope that the Scottish Government will take a balanced view in determining how they use these new powers. It should not be the schemes that are devolved are bad simply because they were designed at Westminster. These schemes have been of great help to many tens of thousands of Scots and provide programmes which are a good foundation on which to build. I'm sorry, no. After all, Deputy Presiding Officer, the terms of reference to the advisory group set up to listen to the views of the stakeholders say that the Scottish Government intend to deliver employability support in Scotland that builds on excellence and experience in the existing service delivery. I have no doubt that the Scottish Government will bring forward changes. After all, surely this will not be yet another example of the Scottish Government gaining powers only to fail to use them. However, one thing I do hope that the Government will bear in mind is the continued need to incentivise work. To provide a range of services that not only deliver support to those seeking employment and training, but to pursue business-friendly policies that will encourage the enterprise which provides these jobs. And very importantly, policies that help retain jobs and keep people in employment. SNP policies have led to the level of job creation in Scotland being the lowest of any of the nations in the UK, and that must change. Scotland's record in creating jobs is behind regions in England such as the North East and Merseyside. These areas have gained by providing a more stable and much more settled destination for businesses. And Deputy Presiding Officer, they do not suffer from a government more interested in reheating constitutional arguments than providing the right environment for growth and job creation. And making Scotland the highest tax part of the UK is not the way to provide the right environment. SNP policies such as doubling the large business rates supplement, which will add over £64 million a year to the cost of Scottish businesses, the replacement of stamp duty and forcing through an increase in the council tax, which will be paid by people in bands E and F, just the sort of people who aspire to save in order that they set up small businesses and indeed provide employment. Deputy Presiding Officer, these are SNP policies that are costing employment and stifling the growth that offers people the best routes into employment. Getting people into work and breaking the cycle of work is the best way and most sustainable way of tackling poverty. Better than any scheme or programme, and I know it's been heard many times today, but I feel it is worth repeating. The Joseph Rowntree Foundation puts it this way: for those who can, work represents the best route out of poverty. Of course, Deputy Presiding Officer, if we assume that the SNP are not going to abandon the policies that deter enterprise and business, there are some things that they should be doing to encourage it. For example, ensuring that disabled people who would currently benefit by the opportunities given by WorkChoice continue to get as good a service under any successor programme. And building on the great work being done by Scotland's local councils in delivering support for employment. The local knowledge and experience gained through its involvement with such bodies as communities planning partnerships must be fully utilised. When we talk about a tailored, localised approach, we mean local authorities working closely with other partners to identify people that need help from various agencies, to bring together services to meet their needs to get back into work, overcoming problems including learning difficulties, health and housing issues. I realise that the Scottish Government has embarked on a consultation exercise. This needs to be a real listening exercise. The views of users, partners, contractors and voluntary bodies need to be considered. No instant dismissal of views of people who highlight good points of the existing programmes. Organisations such as Capability Scotland, Enable and the Shaw Trust have much experience which needs to continue to be put to good use. Finally, Presiding Officer, I said earlier that the Government needs to start taking responsibility. I am pleased that the Conservative amendment recognises the importance of employment programmes and takes out the usual carping from the SNP motion. It is an amendment that I shall have much pleasure in supporting this afternoon. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Ive McKee, then we move to closing speeches.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I begin by putting on the record that the First Minister has appointed me as a Parliamentary Liaison Officer for the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work. I look forward to working with colleagues across the Chamber in that capacity. I'd like to congratulate the Minister on the work he's undertaken to begin to build a distinctive Scottish approach to employment services. It's regrettable that the Scottish Government does not have access to all the powers and economic levers that we need to grow our economy and create all the jobs we need in Scotland, and will continue to make the case for full devolution of job-creating powers. However, the devolution of employment services can still make a huge difference to the lives of people in Scotland, and it's therefore to be warmly welcomed. We have the opportunity to build an employability support system that works for everyone in Scotland, one which has the potential to provide meaningful long-term change. And I'm proud to support the Scottish Government
that rejects Westminster's system of sanctions and punitive measures and instead seeks to create a fairer, more just system with Scotland's people and prosperity at its heart. A skilled workforce brings economic, social and cultural benefits, and the measures announced by the Minister are a significant step in the right direction. The programme of measures announced by the Scottish Government is transitional, focusing on supporting disabled people and those at risk of long-term unemployment. They start the Scottish Employment Services programme off in the right direction and are to be welcomed. There is more work to be done prior to the launch of a full range of employment services in 2018 and beyond, and the Minister has encouraged input from the stakeholders and others that they're designed to support to ensure that we deliver the most effective services for those seeking work. However, our ambitions must be achieved within the constraints of budget cuts from Westminster, the scale of which is significant, a reduction of almost 90% on current DWP spend, although the Scottish Government will invest an additional £20 million a year in Scotland's employability services. And the impact the Westminster cuts creates a challenging environment for the rollout of these new programmes. So while the devolution of these new powers are certainly welcome, the manner in which this has been done is far from satisfactory. Let us be clear, the Scottish Government rejects the sanctions regime imposed by the UK Government, whereby people can have benefits stopped for not taking up places. The evidence shows how damaging the DWP's conditionality regime has been. It disproportionately affects vulnerable people, disabled people, young people and lone parents. And sanctions have increased in length and severity under this UK Government. They can last anywhere from a few days to as long as 3 years. Hardship funds are not available until 15 days into the sanction period, leaving no safety net for vulnerable people. When more people are sanctioned because of the work programme than obtain work from the work programme, it's clearly not fit for purpose. The culture of sanctioning is damaging, often adversely affecting the health and well-being of individuals and their children, reducing rather than enhancing their suitability for work. Furthermore, the threat of being sanctioned is a stigma which feeds into the myth of deserving and undeserving poor. The Scottish Government knows that there is no such distinction. Everyone deserves dignity and respect. In contrast, the Scottish Government's employability programme will have equality and fairness at its heart. We will seek to encourage those furthest from the labour market to achieve social justice and economic outcomes that break the cycle of poverty and unemployment. We will treat people with dignity and respect at every stage of their journey into work and focus on developing their skills to fulfil their employment potential. However, it is important to note that while the Scottish Parliament will take over responsibility for employability programmes, and that there have been devolution of some responsibility for social security related to disability, the UK Government remains entirely responsible for decisions over an individual's entitlement to working age benefits, such as job seekers allowance and employment and support allowance. Unfortunately, this includes all decisions over claimant conditions and sanctions. I welcome the steps taken by the Minister to call on the UK Secretary of State for Work and Pensions to seek confirmation that the Department for Work and Pensions will not force Job Centre Plus clients to take part in a new employment programme as a condition of receiving continuing support.
Polly McNeill.
McKee for giving way, and of course made the same points as him about the vulnerability of people who use the employment service. But I wondered if the member would agree with me that it is important to highlight that there are people who are professional people who find themselves unemployed in today's world who need also the service to enhance their skills.
Adam McKee.
I agree with that. So I think the point you're making is that the initial programmes aren't focused on are focused on a limited number of people. Of course, and as I mentioned earlier in my speech, this is a transitional step, and the Minister will bring forward proposals to roll it out wider as we move forward beyond the initial transitional stage. We fundamentally believe that these programmes will work better if they are voluntary. That brings people with us, makes sure the services are designed around them, and ensures that they're seen as an opportunity and not a threat. Evidently, if the whole system was entirely in the Scottish Parliament's hands, it would be better. People will work with what we have. We will consider the societal and social barriers faced by people returning to work, particularly in the case of disabilities or long-term health conditions. Crucially, we will reject the DWP's approach, which incentivises underemployment and low-paid work, and instead encourage fairer pay, fairer work, and fairer opportunities for all. We believe this is right for Scotland, consistent with our values and aspiration for a person-centred and enabling service for those who we look to support, a system that is fair to people. And the people of Scotland should know that their government will use those powers to ensure that the principles of support, enablement and fairness are the hallmark of our employability programme. Thank you.
Can I thank members for their contribution? We now move to closing speeches. I ask Richard Leonard to close for the Labour Party.
Thanks, Presiding Officer. I wanted to start by recapping the scale of the problem we face, because a few people have spoken in the debate about context. And the context is this, that whilst it's true that last month there were 80,000 men and women in Scotland on the claimant count seeking job seekers allowance, claiming job seekers allowance, there were in fact 130,000 working men and women officially unemployed in Scotland. And on top of that, over 180,000 people of working age in Scotland are described in the annual population survey by the ONS as currently economically inactive, but who want to work. That's 310,000 people of working age in Scotland seeking work today. That's not 5%, it's nearly 12% of the workforce. These levels of involuntary mass unemployment and worklessness do not just represent a failure of our economy, they represent a failure of our society too. And there are human faces behind these stark statistics. Over the summer, I met with the Airdrie ACE Group, a group of adults in Lanarkshire with learning disabilities. Enable has brought them together to empower them, to give them a voice. And I promised when I met with them in August that I would bring their concerns to the floor of this Parliament and push their case up the Scottish Government's agenda, because they are simply demanding equality and they are right. Most of them are seeking work. None of them are in work, although one has started college and one works as an unpaid volunteer in a workplace where, frankly, he could be in paid employment. Joblessness amongst adults with a learning disability stands at over 92%. 92%. And yet the vast majority, like those young people in Airdrie, want to work. And the picture for people with mental health issues is similar. That's why we welcome the introduction of a work-able strand in the Scottish Government programme. But I do want to turn to the question of resources. £4.8 million is being allocated to deliver that target of 1,500 starts. But if we're to do this properly, as I believe we must, if we are to support individuals to the extent I think we need to support them, then the Minister either needs to increase the funding or have a more realistic target. And we need to make sure, of course.
Minister.
You will accept that there has been an 87% funding cut for the delivery of these programmes by the UK government, and which is £7 million for the coming financial year. We've leveraged in an additional £20 million.
Richard Leonard.
Yeah, I accept that, and I reflect on that cut to Mr. Tompkins, that if the job programme is so successful, why are they slashing it by such a big amount of money? But what I want to go on to say in the limited time I've got left is this, and Maurice Golden touched on this earlier on. Recently, I asked a parliamentary question about the government's framework for supported factories and businesses, and John Mason touched on this too in his contribution. And I discovered that since 2012, only £1.9 million worth of orders have been placed with supported businesses by public bodies in Scotland, with an average value per order of less than £5,000. So I say to all of those public bodies in Scotland, that's simply not good enough. And I say to the Minister, let's redouble the Scottish Government's efforts. I think, listening to the debate, we need to decide when we come to design the work programme here, what it is we are aiming to achieve. And to Annie Wells, who asked us to build on the existing work programme, I say this, when the Tory Liberal Coalition, for it was they who introduced the work programme, brought it in, they said it was a major new payment for results welfare to work programme. And it was central to the coalition government's ambitious programme of welfare reform. So there we have it, a programme unashamedly not about growing work and tackling mass unemployment, but about cutting welfare payments. And at the launch, the Tory government, the Tory coalition said that it was a flagship at the leading edge of wider government commissioning of payment for results public services. Now I say to the Minister here
that we don't want payments for results public services. We want publicly run public services. We are not hiring taxes. We are providing employment support to working people. And we know that in Scotland, the two prime providers of the work programme are not Job Centre Plus. They are Working Links and Ingeus, two large multinational corporations whose first fiduciary duty is to make money for their owners. And so I say to this this afternoon that we would like the Minister to seriously and continuously explore whether there are alternatives to that form of provision. We also need to ask, finally, a couple of things. Do we want action simply on the supply side of the labour market, or should we be looking more at action on the demand side of the labour market? Do we not need investment in reindustrialisation, investment in public services, not four more years of austerity? We need a radical but achievable economic strategy so we can expand the real economy and generate jobs. We need the readoption. We need the readoption of full employment as a policy objective, so that, in the words of William Beveridge, referred to by Willie Rennie, jobs rather than men, and I would add women, should wait. As Mark Griffin said, with the devolution of employment support, we have an historic opportunity, because the challenges we face are not new. They are problems earlier generations faced up to and overcame. So let's not just demonstrate our concern this afternoon, let's prove our willingness to act, and let us leave no one in any doubt about the scale of our ambition for change, our determination to rebuild a full employment economy for all for this generation. I call on Parliament to support the government motion with the Labour amendment.
I call on Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The devolution of employment support services marks yet another significant transfer of power to this Parliament. With these new powers comes significant responsibility for the Scottish Government, because it will be assuming power in areas of policy where there has been meaningful success in recent years. Policies such as the work programme have helped almost 50,000 unemployed people in Scotland into the job market. And more importantly, it's helped many families in Scotland break the desperate cycle of multi-generational welfare dependency. Long-term unemployment rates are now at the lowest levels since Labour's Great Recession. There are more disabled people in work, and overall, 2.7 million new jobs have been created since 2010. Most importantly, perhaps, 500,000 fewer children now live in workless households, something that will greatly enhance their life chances. And just to address something Richard Leonard said, the success of the UK's government's economic strategy in creating 2.7 million new jobs and reducing long-term structural unemployment means there's less need for funding for the work programme, because it has been a success. So this is all very positive, but there is more to be done. There's more to be done to help those who need additional support to access the job market, and more to be done to expand the job market and the economy in Scotland. To address these issues going forward, the Scottish Government will have control over a range of existing employability powers and benefits, and the power to introduce new support services such as Work First and Workable. Mr Hepburn today provided an outline of the government's plans, but it was more about the direction of travel rather than details of how these new policies will be implemented and how they will be funded. Based on today's debate, there is clearly no shortage of advice about how this might work in Scotland. So I would like to pick up on some of the issues raised across the chamber this afternoon. First of all, a number of members discussed the principles that should underpin employment support in Scotland in the future. There were obviously a number of different viewpoints on this issue. The view on this side of the chamber is that we should follow the principles underpinning the success of work programme and work choice. Most importantly, and again, it has been mentioned by a few members, we should follow the advice provided by the Joseph Rowntree Foundation that for those who can, work represents the best way out of poverty. And we should also remember the analysis that shows that additional spending on benefits without addressing the underlying root cause of poverty has failed to reduce poverty. Mm-hmm. This overall approach, which we favour, recognises the importance of using policy as a means of encouraging people into work. if necessary, with additional financial or other in-work support. This has to be better than policies which discourage or put barriers in the way to the transition into work. It should always pay to be in employment. And yes, in order to be fully eligible for the benefits of JSA or equivalent benefits going forward, some action to show that the claimant is willing and able to work have to be taken. If you're claiming job seeker allowance, then it makes sense that you have to be taking steps to find a job and be available to take steps to find a job. According to the DWP, more than 70% of claimants say they are more likely to follow the rules if they risk having their benefits stopped, a view supported by the independent recent Oakley review.
Yeah.
I will in a minute. To put this into context, the UK has a far less strict benefit sanctions regime compared to other European countries, such as Ireland and Sweden,
That's true. Yep.
And is less strict than the European Union average.
That's true.
Other members have made valuable contributions in respect of the increasing opportunities for disabled people to fully participate in the workplace under work choice, which is entirely voluntary. 365,000 more disabled people have moved into work over the past 2 years. And our target is to halve the disability employment gap for disabled people by 2020. And as Adam Tomkin said, we look forward to hearing whether the Scottish Government is able or willing to match this commitment. I'll give way.
Polly McNeill.
Thank you very much. No one is saying that there shouldn't ever be sanctions, and no one is denying that being in work is more important. But is the... Are the benches opposite going to address at any stage in this debate the draconian nature of some sanctions? And I asked the member directly, in the case that I provide, and it's not uncommon, is it fair, therefore, that you should have your benefits removed for 6 weeks? Is that fair?
Dean Lockhart.
I obviously can't comment on individual cases, but sanctions affect only a small... Well, let me address it. Sanctions affect only a small number of claimants. Less than 2.5% of JSA claimants are sanctioned, and only 0.26% of ESA claimants are sanctioned. Perspective is important on this issue.
Absolutely.
I've answered the question. Another topic mentioned during this debate, and indeed from a number of third sector contributors, ahead of the debate, was the need for greater integration and cooperation between employment support and other policy areas. Some good examples have come out of the debate. The fact that 152,000 college places have been cut really means that has created a skills gap precisely at a time when the economy needs new and developing skills across all sectors. To have unemployment levels at 5% and at the same, not right now, maybe later, and at the same time as having unemployment at 5%, having a significant skills gap after 10 years in government simply isn't good enough. Other members have rightly highlighted that we need to improve the employment chances of children from our poorest backgrounds. In this chamber, we have discussed the attainment gap, but less attention has been given to the digital gap emerging across our schools. Yes. Figures published in August by Scotland IS show that the number of computer teachers in Scotland has dropped by 25% in the past decade, and that 17 local authorities have no dedicated computer teachers available. With research by Tinder Foundation, mentioned by another member, showing that 90% of all new jobs require digital skills, we're simply not equipping our children with the skills necessary for employment in the future. The Scottish Government should also be focused on the apprenticeship levy and use the apprenticeship levy to address the number of young people in deprived areas who are not in education, employment or training. The dismal figure that Annie Wells mentioned of over 400,000 young people between the age of 16 and 24 who are not in education, employment or training. Again, after 10 years in government, simply not good enough. Finally, another issue raised has been inclusive growth. And to be fair, I'm wrapping up. To be fair to Mr. Hepburn, the SNP motion does refer to a more prosperous Scotland and inclusive growth. What I would say, Mr. Hepburn, is in order for economic growth to be inclusive, there has to be economic growth in the first place. Exactly. The Scottish economy recorded zero growth in the first quarter of this year, and GDP growth numbers for the second quarter, ending 30th of June, have mysteriously been delayed for publication until next week, coincidentally during parliamentary recess. Is this another example of the SNP trying to bury bad news during recess? Absolutely. Presiding officer, it is becoming clear, as the Fraser of Allender Institute has made clear, that the Scottish economy must improve its performance because more public spending will be determined by the performance of the Scottish economy. And that is why in our motion we highlight the need for the government to take action, to use its expanding powers to grow employment, the employment market in Scotland, and indeed reverse the decline in the Scottish economy. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Lockhart. I ask the Minister to wind up. And Minister, you have until 17:29.
A very precise time indeed, President Officer. I shall do my very best. Can I begin by thanking members for their contributions today? I won't be able to pick up on every single point that has been raised in the context of this debate. I will try to respond to as many as I can. Mr. Lockhart is right to identify, as I think I set out at the start of today's debate, that this is an opportunity, a chance for members to offer their perspectives on how we take these powers forward in the future. And I think it has been a very useful, or largely useful in that regard, Presiding Officer. It's been wide-ranging. A number of suggestions have been made, and we will look at all in detail as we develop services going forward. Having mentioned Mr. Lockhart, I thought it was very instructive, very informative about him criticising the Scottish Government for a delay in the publication of GDP figures. Of course, these are figures that we source from the Office of National Statistics. We have no control over that timing. So I would urge him to reflect on that and perhaps take that up with others who might be more forthcoming with such information if he takes such a particular interest in these matters, of course.
One option, of course, is to push back the publication of the numbers so that it can be, when Parliament is back, it can be subject to full scrutiny and debate.
Yeah. Minister.
Well, I think I would go back to the point that I've just made, Mr. Lockhart. We are not in control over the publication of these figures, and perhaps you want to take up the matter with those who have responsibility for such. But I would reflect on the fact, of course, if they're published, it's perfectly possible for any member of this Parliament to reflect on the statistics that have been published and bring that matter up when we are back after recess. And I'm sure I look forward with great interest to see your take on that matter, Mr. Lockhart. Alec Rowley spoke about the need for involvement of a range of people in this process in terms of informing the work that we take forward. I think he particularly was referring to trade unions and local authorities as having a role to play in that regard. I would absolutely concur with that perspective. I'm sure he'll be happy to know that we have established a devolved employment services advisory group, which is independently chaired by Professor Alan McGregor, who is the director of University of Glasgow's Training and Employment Research Unit, with many years, more years than he probably would care for me to make clear to Parliament, many years' experience in this particular area. And he is directing that work. I'm sure Mr. Rowley would be happy to know that the Scottish Trades Union Congress is represented on that group, as is local government through the Scottish Local Authority Economic Development Group. So we are taking forward that range of involvement. But to bottom out the point that Mr. Rowley made around local authorities playing a leadership role in delivering employment support at a local level, I wouldn't actually disagree with that perspective that Mr. Rowley has raised. I've been very happy to meet with Councillor Harry McGuigan, as I always am happy to meet Councillor Harry McGuigan in his capacity and his spokesperson role through COS. I met him last month. We had a very productive discussion about the need for us to work productively together to ensure that all elements of employment support, be they provided by us as a Scottish Government with this new element of the devolved employment programme, or be they delivered by local authorities, for them to work together more cohesively. That isn't an easy challenge to respond to, but it's one that both I and Councillor McGuigan were keen to see taken forward, and Scottish Government officials will be meeting the Scottish Local Authorities Economic Development Employability Group later this month to see how we can take that particular agenda forward. Annie Wells spoke about the need to reach out to those who need support most. I could not disagree with that perspective. I think that's going to be essential going forward. But she did also say we need to learn from the current schemes as are deployed. Adam Tomkins spoke of the benefits of the pricing model and the payment model currently used. He suggested it incentivised sustained employment. But I have been out, it will come as no surprise to Professor Tomkins, I've been engaging with a range of people in these matters, and I've heard that through the current system there are perverse disincentives through that current model for working with those who need the most support. And indeed, the DWP evaluation confirms that. My meeting this morning with One Parent Family Scotland discussed the problems of the payment by results model. So whilst, of course, there will be expectations for outcomes from providers to get people into sustained employment, we do need to recognise that issue I've raised about the perverse disincentive to reach out to those who need more support. We need to recognise the need to take account of various factors affecting people's lives, a point made by Sandra White and Christina McKelvey and Alec Rowley, and it may require us to take a slightly more nuanced approach. Can I welcome the comments from Pauline McNeill? She's saying she is broadly supportive of our approach. That is very welcome. That seemed to be reflected by most contributors to the debate today. She was very clear. She hopes not to see a fight between the Scottish Government and the UK Government. Neither do I, to be clear. And I'm sure this will reassure Willie Rennie, who also took an interest in this particular aspect. We have been working very closely with the DWP and Job Centre Plus from the very start to see the effective devolution of these powers. There's been effective intergovernmental working to see the delivery of these powers. There's been the establishment of a joint ministerial working group to oversee the smooth transition of new social security employability powers to Scotland. I look forward to attending the next meeting of that particular group next week. On the advisory group that I just referred to a second ago, we have DWP representation, we have Job Centre Plus representation. Officials from both governments meet on a regular basis. We have joint working embedded in a number of areas. So I am in no way seeking a confrontation with the UK government. But what we do have is a letter from Ian Duncan Smith to the then Cabinet Secretary for Fair Work Skills and Training on the 16th of December 2015, which says very clearly the design of employment support programmes in Scotland will be for the Scottish Government to decide, including the extent of conditionality in those programmes. What we do have is a letter from Damien Green to myself this week that says, with regards to employability programmes being transferred to the Scottish Parliament under the Scotland Act 2016, it is of course a matter for the Scottish Government to decide how conditionality should be applied and practised. Now, I can demonstrate clear work between the governments. We're not fighting between one another, but that does not mean that I will not robustly defend the approach that we seek to take here in Scotland with our employment programme. And let me be clear, given what we have had in writing from the UK government, not once but twice now, I expect the UK government to respect our perspective here in Scotland. I will continue to work with them to make sure that it happens going forward. In demonstrating our voluntary approach to the delivery of these programmes as the best way forward, Mr Rennie, Mr Leonard spoke about William Beveridge. He, of course, once said that the state in organising security should leave room for encouragement and voluntary action by each individual to provide more than that minimum for, using the gendered language of the time, himself and his family. A voluntary approach is entirely consistent with the approach we have taken with our other employability programmes. I believe that allows us to take people with us rather than working against them. I believe it can deliver a person-centred, person-focused approach. I believe we can deliver more with that approach, Presiding Officer. And that has to be about ensuring that we can disaggregate ourselves from entanglement with, I think, the debunked, failed UK government sanctions regime that it was very interesting to hear successive Conservative speakers refer to the point made by the Joseph Rowntree Foundation for those who can work employment as the best route out of poverty. Not a single member of this chamber will disagree with that. But what I didn't hear from Professor Tompkins or Alison Harris or indeed Mr Lockhart is that the Joseph Rowntree Foundation have also said benefit sanctions lead to unfavourable longer-term outcomes for earnings, job quality and employment retention. And when we hear successive speaker after speaker tell us, and I can speak from my own constituency experience dealing with constituents going through that regime, when we hear story after story of the real practical effect of sanctions on the ground, let me say to Ms Harris, we are not carping. We are seeking to protect the interests of the people of Scotland, and our employability programme will in no way facilitate the UK government sanctions regime.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate on devolution of employment services. The next item of business is consideration of Business Bureau Motion 1813 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a business programme. I would ask any member who wishes to speak against the motion to press their request to speak button now, and I call on Joe Fitzpatrick to move the motion.
Formally moved.
No member has asked to speak against the motion. Therefore, I put the question to the Chamber. The question is that we agree motion number 1813. Do we all agree? We do all agree. The next item of business is consideration of 9 Parliamentary Bureau motions. I would ask Joe Fitzpatrick to move en bloc motion 1819 on the variation of standing orders, motions 1820 to 1826 on the approval of SSIs, and motion 1827 on the suspension of standing orders.
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. We now move to decision time. And the first question this afternoon is that amendment 1793.1 in the name of Adam Tompkins, which seeks to amend motion 1793 in the name of Jamie Hepburn on devolution of employment services, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. Parliament will move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 1793.1 in the name of Adam Tompkins is yes 30, no 93. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. The next question is that Amendment 1793.3 in the name of Polly McNeill, which seeks to amend Motion 1793, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. Parliament will move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on Amendment 1793.3 in the name of Polly McNeill is yes 93, no 30. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore agreed. And the next question is that motion 1793 in the name of Jamie Hepburn as amended is agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We're not agreed. Parliament will move to a vote and members may cast their votes now. The result of the vote on motion 1793 in the name of Jamie Hepburn as amended is as follows. Yes, 92. No, 30. There were no abstentions. The motion as amended is therefore agreed. I propose to ask a single question on the nine parliamentary bureau motions 1819 to 1827. If any member objects to a single question being put, please say so now. No members objected. The question is that motions 1819 to 1827 in the name of Joe Fitzpatrick be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are all agreed. That concludes decision time. We're now moving to members' business. We'll take a few moments for members to change their seats and for the minister to change seats too.